Today I was planning, or I'm going to show you my, or to explain you my new project. I just began this the last October, so it has been I have been working on this for a very few months. But as the methodology and some aspects of this project is very similar to what I've been doing in my past research, I also will show you some results of other projects, and I hope to be able to convince you about the use of network analysis for transportation. So you will see. Okay, well, my project is now is called Mercatore. The idea is to analyze a very big frame or time frame to analyze the transportation networks in a very big frame of time. In that case, is from the Roman times and to the 19th century. So I analyze the evolution, the continuities, and the changes of these networks in a concrete area. Why I want to analyze the roads or the transportation system? Obviously, because we know that from Roman times, the roads are all of the transport were elements related with economy. In that roads, we know that a lot of commodities, products were import and export. It means a lot in the economy of Roman Empire. They also has a very effects on politics. We know the propaganda effect of building a new road. The Roman Empire showed their power and their benefits, or the benefits of being conquered by Romans in a territory, building new roads and showing people the wellness of being connected to Rome. Also because roads means a lot of the territorial organization. When Romans arrived to a place, they built a new communication system, and all of this reflected in that territory. And also the roads had a social impact, because in the roads people and ideas and religion moved and get connected. We know that the Roman Empire built a complex transportation system. With these networks, they connected territories, people, society. So this is an important element to analyze in Roman history. The territory that I'm going to explain today, and I will be working for the next month, will be the Iberian Peninsula. The reasons to choose the Iberian Peninsula are clear. First of all, by its geography, it's an almost closed area, which is more easy and understandable to analyze and to get conclusions. It's more difficult when you have only one part of a territory with, and you didn't know all of the network systems. In that case, except on the Pyrenees, all of the network in that territory is known and is closed. The size for my research is affordable. It's big, which it means that I can get conclusions or interesting conclusions, but it's not big enough to make it impossible for me to analyze that. About the chronology of the Iberian Peninsula in this big time frame is interesting. First, because we have a very different political systems from Roman times until the 19th century. We have we can say occupation in Roman times. We have the existence of different countries in medieval periods. Or after that, we have a very centralist monarchies, which means a different conceptualization of the transportation. And obviously, this is a very good place because we have a lot of information, and we can get a strong archaeological and historical data. The objectives of this new project, the first one obviously is get all of the information and digitalize that in a GIS. The second one is to analyze the connectivity. In a sense, something to change the system. There are some mistakes, but the idea is to analyze the connectivity of this network in the sense that we make relationships between people and connections. We can do the same or something similar between roads and towns. We have talked about that a lot, so you know what I'm talking about. After that, other of the objectives is to analyze how this network worked, thinking in transportation systems. Then, obviously, with all of these results, make some analysis of the impact of these transportation systems, and obviously, finally, make the diffusion. In my case, when I analyzed the connectivity of a transportation system, my main concept was that it's simpler comparing with other systems, but it worked for me at least until now. The idea is that the most important cities, thinking in economically or political ways, the more important cities are always the cities that are more connected. We can think now in cities like Amsterdam, London, or Paris, we can see their importance also in the number of infrastructures that they have, the number of highways, the number of train stations or connections with airports, etc. I think that in that sense, we can do something similar in Roman times. The most important cities must be always the most well connected. To do that, we know that there are different ways to analyze that. I used only the central degree. It's the simpler. I know that, but I thought that for this first approach, it worked in that analysis. So how taking into account how much more connections a town has, more important must be this approach. The only variation that I did in that sense, sorry. The only variation that I made was to take to make a different valuation of the DHs depending on the mean of transport that they represented. We can understand that in Roman times and also now, not all of the means of transport has the same meaning. What I did was to make a different valuation. The connection of the possibility to export or import products with a seaport must have a more importance than to have the connection of a secondary road. And we can do the same with the river transport or with or the possibility to have a main road or a secondary road. Doing that, as you can see in both graphs, in the second one, depending of the meaning of these edges and the value of these edges, the results of the connectivity were different. This is my first approach. It was the northeast of the Iberian Peninsula, now is Catalonia. I did this analysis of connectivity in that place, and what I found was three different ways of connecting territories following the transportation system. On one side, in the south, what we have are big cities. Big cities that are all of them are well connected, but only in one point, which are big cities. On the contrary, in the north coast, what we have is territories that are all well connected, but they don't have a very big city. What we found is the existence of different points of different small cities that all of them are well connected between them, but you don't have one single point well connected. It's interesting to find the differences between these two systems, because in the south we found the capital of the all of the province of the Tarraconense, which is Tarraco, is here. We also have Ilerda, which was a very big city and was connected with the river Ebro and with the north, with the Pyrenees. And Dertosa too, it was a very important point because it was a sea and fluvial port. So these three big cities were too big that they didn't allow to the creation of new populations in their surroundings. So all of the communications always come to that cities. What we had in the north in exchange was different. No, we have different small cities. All of them needed the help, or they needed to get connected with other populations. And obviously in the north, which is in the Pyrenees, we have a very bad connectivity. I did the same for all of the peninsula. In that sense, we can see different well-connected zones in yellow or in red. All of them always are related with the capital provinces, or with in the north with the gold extraction, and we can compare that with a map that I did a few time ago of the connectivity in the 16th century. You can see the differences between territories and how the network is completely different from one time in Roman times and in the 16th century. This is again all of the roads in Spain, in Hispania. This is the connectivity in that area. And the idea is that you can compare that with different archaeological elements. In that case, are the coin mints. All of them, or most of them, were located in the most well-connected areas. We can do the same with the size of the cities. Each circle means the size of the cities, and you can compare. Or you can see how not all of them, but most of them are located. The biggest cities were always well connected, or with the most productive areas in Hispania. The second aspect that I've been working in all of this time was to analyze how these networks worked. In that sense, what I made was knowing in a GIS, knowing all of the length of all of the transportation networks, what I made was to use a constant values per kilometer to analyze how cost to transport an element from one point to another, or from one point to the rest of the network. To do that, I analyzed also the time of travel and the cost of travel. The time was easier because as I know the length and I know the speed of each main kind of transport, it's easy to calculate this value. Which is more complicated, which is more difficult, is to analyze the cost of travel. But I use some values which have been published before to do that. Interesting results. This is from an old project, but what was interesting in that results was to analyze the location of different cities related with the time of transport from the capital. In that case, Tarraco. Tarraco was the first city built in this territory. After Tarraco, they built the others. You can see how the majority of the cities were built at least at 3 days of travel from Tarraco. Another interesting result was to analyze in the surroundings of Barquino. We have two different elements that shows the limit of the city, of the territory of the city. Both are located very close to what these results show as 1 day of travel. So it's interesting to show how the limits of a city can get related with the time of travel. Analyzing the cost of travel, what we found was we can compare the cost of travel with some archaeological elements. In that case, this is an amphora from Bética. You can see how the distribution of this kind of element is related also with the cost of travel, the cost of transport in that territory. Doing the same, but for all the Hispania, we can compare how different must be the cost of transport from different parts of this geography. In that case, you can see the big one is from Barquino, in the upper part of this slide. You can see in the center of Spain, this is Complutum, very close to Madrid now. And in the south, you can see in Hispalis, which was in Mérida, which was another capital of a province. We can compare also this cost of these results with the size of the cities. We can see how most of them are also related with this cost, which is more interesting, or which is also interesting, is to look where the Romans located the most productive settlements in Hispania, and how they are always related with these costs. This is the distribution of this kind of amphora. And again, with the coin mines, no? So the idea of this results is to compare what we get of the functioning or the accessibility of these points with the archaeological material. So to synthesize in that sense, what we get doing this kind of projects is quantified data. So this quantified data is telling us about the configuration and the function of these networks and all of this system. And the idea is finally to make a statistical analysis about comparing these results with the urban connectivity, the territorial organization of these territories, comparisons with the transport movement or historical commerce. There are not conclusions yet, but to show some things which are interesting is that, as I said before, normally the biggest cities are always located or are always more well connected and are always located in a transportation an economical transportation good area. There are some cities and some points that they don't follow these rules. I'm not yet in that point, but the idea is to find the reasons of the existence of these ambiguities, maybe, or these cities that don't follow, or that cities that don't follow these rules about the connections or transportation economics, no? It happened the same with It happened the same with the coin mines, why they were placed in that places and not in another. We can see of most of them are well connected, but we have some of them that not, and think about that and take conclusions about these things. And another interesting point is the location of procuratores and beneficiaries. These are people related with the transport and with the supply of armies. Most of them are always located. Most Most of them are always located in the capital provinces, but we have in the north, and we have in places that maybe it seems to be for other reasons that I'm not yet in that point, but I have to think on the, on that. And to conclude, I want to say that this is an unfinished project, at least I began just in October, but it shows interesting results. It provides new data for the study of history and an economy of Rome. To say also that the study of Roman transport network is very necessary, at least they give new information or information that we didn't have yet about a Roman economy or history. The transportation network in Roman times, I think it was indispensable to keep together these territories. The political integration of Rome required a good cohesion, and it was made from economy and also of course, on communication. And the transport network was a key factor to the success of Roman Empire, at least at the beginning. And well, for the future, the idea in this project is not only to analyze the Roman times, but to compare this territory over the centuries. The idea is to analyze the differences and the continuities of these networks and try to get conclusions about the political decisions, the religious configuration. It was important, especially in medieval times. Also, the division, the political division between Spain and Portugal, how it affected the transportation networks, and a lot of other things. And thank you. That's all.